Today, our panel is about technology. The meetup is about if disruptive technology really still can revolutionize photography. We have amazing speakers. We have a fantastic moderator. And here are quickly our speakers. Noah, our moderator, will give you more detail to them in person. But let me quickly talk about Noah, who is a man of many accomplishments. And we are very happy to have him here tonight as our moderator. He has he comes from the Columbia School of Journalism, was part of, I think, the first digital reporting class taught at Columbia. He has helped to launch the Time Inc. website while he was still in school. He helped bring Time and other magazines into the digital age. He created tons of online presences and interesting news formats. He was a freelance writer. He was a commentator on television, whether it was CNN, ABC, or MTV. He was an associate producer on an Emmy-winning TV Nation. He's also the creator of the co-network of co-design, co-create, co-exist, and co-labs, which has won the National Magazine Award. And now he's also the executive editor of Fast Company.
So today I had a weird interaction that I wanted to tell you about, start by telling you about with Facebook, which is that I uploaded a series of slides to Facebook, a series of images that were created by a computer. It was actually a new program that takes animation and fills in the gaps, so it sort of auto-animates for you. So I uploaded these slides to Facebook so that I could promote them, and I instantly got back an error message that one of the slides was rejected for promotion because it had a picture of a play button in it, which had come from sort of the screenshot of the computer. And I was talking with Matt about this, and we're both pretty sure that that was actually artificial intelligence that spit back that there was a problem with that image, that it didn't meet their sort of like what Facebook's guidelines are for uploading images. So basically, I had taken an image created by a computer, put it into Facebook, and had a computer tell me that there was an error in that image. And I think that was a good sort of like getting into the headspace of some of the things we're talking about tonight, which is that we're in a weird place where things are changing still really rapidly, where all the changes that we thought have happened in the last 10 or 20 years with photography, like, it's still moving so quickly. And so tonight, we're going to try to really push, I think, the boundaries of what you know and are kind of challenge you a little bit with some of the technology that's happening out there. And to give you a sense of how quickly it's moving, there are a few things that have happened that I wanted to just briefly mention that I wonder if you all had known about, which was one, did you hear about the JPEG group, you know, the people who make the standard, the JPEG standard? They met in Brussels to discuss adding DRM to the format, which is digital rights management. Were people aware of this? Okay, are you in favor of that idea? You'll know what DRM is, right? Raise your hand, yes? Yeah, did you want to add, I wasn't sure if you had a question. Yeah, but okay, so you're in favor. Okay, so a few people in favor. Who's against it? Who thinks that we should not add DRM to it? And who's like, thinks maybe,
DRM,
digital rights management. So it basically allows, it makes it less likely that you can copy that image or that you can, it's like what they do with music to say, hey, this is owned by somebody and if you use it, you have to pay for it in order to be able to see the image, right? Or to be able to certainly resell the image. Well, that's one of the things that actually Denis is gonna talk about. I mean, this gets right into the heart of some of the things that he's doing with mine. So that's a really interesting thing. Light is a new camera, the L16. Have you guys heard about the L16? Did you see that from a few weeks ago? This is a camera that has it's a multiple aperture device that looks like it does 10 camera, it actually fires 10 cameras simultaneously, and it's about the size of an iPhone, and then it lets you choose from all of the different images and image styles. And so similar, I don't think quite a competitor to DxO, which Jean-Marc has. We'll talk about that, okay, good. So, but that's a new camera that got a lot of buzz and a lot of like press when that came out, right? And then finally, I just heard about today, this week, a photographer named Rachel Hewlin announced that she's publishing the first Instagram novel over the next 9 months. So she's basically publishing a series of images with a story that goes with it, and she's using the platform to tell stories, which is a totally different way of thinking about Instagram and how to use that medium. And so I think that's very interesting. And Matt, with Clarifai, one of the challenges I have for him in talking about artificial intelligence is like, okay, so what does this allow us to do? How do we take this and use this as storytellers, as photographers, right? How do we go beyond just the ability to identify a cat from a dog, or the next step, which was different breeds of dogs that they can do now, right? So that's what we're gonna be getting into tonight. And so the way it's gonna work is I'm gonna call each of them, I'm gonna introduce each of them, they're gonna do a presentation so that you understand the technology that they're working with. And at the end, we'll all get up here and we can ask questions, so please save your questions until the end. But I also would like you to challenge them, ask hard questions, you know, don't hesitate to say if you don't understand something, but also challenge them even on some of the philosophical underpinnings maybe of what they're talking about, because this is kind of getting out into a territory that is unexplored, right? Okay, sound good? You all got that? You with me? Great. All right. So the first person who's going to speak tonight is Denis Nazarov. He is the CEO of Mine. He will explain what Mine is. I'm going to tell you a little bit about his background. He's got a BFA in photography, and he studied new media, and then became a freelance software engineer, which is an interesting kind of pathway to take. Not everyone goes in that direction. And he really did that because he wanted to solve some of the problems he saw with photos online. And I think that's something you'll see across all of our panelists tonight, is they're trying to solve problems that they're seeing with the way kind of technology's working. And so he gets at the heart of that. And so with that, Denis.
Thank you, Noah. My name is Denis Nazarov. Just to start, a little bit more about my background and my relationship with ICP. My first job in college was actually across the street at the ICP Museum, working at the bookstore, and that's probably where I spent the most time actually looking at photographs, where I was just behind the cash register flipping through photo books. And also Fred Richin, who is your dean here, was one of my professors at NYU, what he taught us really inspired me, and what about digital media. And I think like just something I can't forget is like reading Borges and reading about quantum physics, things you would think are completely unrelated to photography. I think kind of the things that had nothing to do with photography really helped me understand photography. And so at NYU, I really struggled. We learned traditional photography methods, and my fellow students were sort of like obsessed and evangelical about like film photography and 35 millimeter. Like, I think students were like literally ready to organize sit-ins, so like the color printing machine would not be taken out of the department. And so there was a conflict of this kind of nostalgia, love for the craft and what the 20th century has produced, with the reality of social networks coming and growing around the time from like 2007 to 2011. And I was really confused about making work and being an artist in New York and contributing to this like cacophony and noise of images around the world, and just understanding like how the network worked, why all these images were propagating. And just thinking about that led me to explore like how these networks work and trying to understand them deep from the infrastructure itself. And that is what led me and the people I'm working with to start Mine. And that's what I'm going to be talking about. So Mine is a decentralized image annotation and attribution platform. So every day, as you know, billions of images are shared online. But unfortunately, they're mostly dumb. They lack credits, context, or depth. They're just stuff, posts in your feed. And you can imagine seeing images of a cow chewing cud, a cop at a pool party, a celebrity wardrobe malfunction, the Mona Lisa, a cool-looking chair. And stuff is great, and everybody loves stuff, but there's currently no way to actually learn about anything, about all that great stuff you're seeing. And that's because the internet is blind. The way the internet works is that it doesn't see images, it doesn't know what's in them, who made them, or even if two images are the same. And what happens is that every time an image is shared, it gets broken. It's broken up from its from its maker, its story, and even itself. And if you take the time to add in the credits, the captions, and links, the next person won't, and each new post buries the last. So imagine that the New York Times publishes a moving article with a captivating image, and readers share this image on social media with an informative caption, and their followers repost it. Some bother to recaption it, but it's easier and faster not to. The image spreads and inevitably becomes harder and harder to find the original with its attribution concepts, context, and depth of meaning. And in effect, an image circulated by thousands of well-intentioned people has diluted its message and power. So sharing has actually decreased human knowledge. And this particular example is a graphic, some graphic images from the Syrian refugee crisis of a boy that drowned off the coast of Turkey, which was widely circulated on social media in September. But the discourse around this wide sharing was fractured, and it often lacked the important context provided by the original posts in the news outlets. So when a network is ignorant about what it's sharing, ignorance itself becomes a network effect. And that poses problems for both creators and consumers. So creators, they cannot derive the value from the spread of their works because it's impossible to discover their identity. And for consumers, they're disenfranchised because they can't have rich interactions with the media or its author. So if you're a creator and your image goes viral, no one knows that you made it. And as a viewer, you only get to look at pretty rectangles without the ability to know the history of the image, the author behind it, or the conversation around it. And what we're trying to do at Mind is to create a smarter internet for images. So talk about how that works. So this is how humans see images. On the top there is it's two different versions of the Mona Lisa as you might see them in the real world, and there's a poster on top and a billboard at the bottom that you might see while you're driving a car. So when the human visual apparatus sees these two images, it knows that they actually represent one thing. So if you see these two things, you're actually talking about the Mona Lisa physical painting by an artist. So if later that day you call your friend and you're having a conversation about the Mona Lisa, you both are talking about one canonical representation. And we aim to computerize and automate this digitally at Mind using computer vision. So at the top is, you can imagine a high-res JPEG that exists somewhere in one place on the internet, and at the bottom is a low-res PNG image that is slightly bluer. And using computer vision, we can resolve two of these instances to one identifier. So that allows Mind to connect thousands of different appearances of an image over thousands of contexts across any platform into one record. So that creates a permanent home where everything about that image can be collected and known, and the entire ripple it creates as it makes its way across the internet can be preserved. So we call the underlying infrastructure the canonical content registry, which is an open protocol. It allows registering a unique global identifier representing the canonical idea for a work of digital media. And this one singular identifier functions as a hook for persistent metadata. So any version of an image you see online anywhere, it can resolve to this relevant metadata. And this infrastructure is built on top of the blockchain. And the blockchain is the technology that powers Bitcoin. And it's what enables, in the case of Bitcoin, for two parties to have a financial transaction without a middleman. So using the blockchain, it enables Mind to timestamp all the metadata in the system, which proves that this informational claim was made at a certain point in time, irrefutably. It is cryptographically signed with the user's identity, and it's permanently recorded in this open database. So this makes the data on Mind decentralized, transparent, and public. So the implications of this are pretty broad. That means that a single master entry for an image where every instance across the web and all the information about it is linked and preserved, and the author's identity is discoverable through the image itself and cannot be removed. And any member of the Mind community has the ability to add and edit knowledge in the system in a Wikipedia, in a wiki-style fashion. So that makes Mind a platform that is similar to a Wikipedia for images, a Rap Genius for images, a Quora for images, or a Shazam for images. So in effect, Mind turns images into knowledge vectors. So what this can enable is that an image becomes a gateway to its creator. So imagine that you could know the identity of the author of any image you saw on the internet just by virtue of seeing it. It didn't, no one had to, like, with text, put it beneath the image. Just by seeing the image itself, you could resolve it to this permanent record with the author. So you could start a dialogue with this creator, express appreciation of their work, or even send them a payment in Bitcoin. So by virtue of seeing an image, mine enables the image to become a path to more work by that author. So imagine you see one random image by Picasso from the Blue Period, and if you could instantly resolve to Picasso's other works from that time, and which will be meticulously organized by the community with deep annotations and no redundancy. Mine enables every image to become a gateway to its story. And this is important because every image is not just something to look at and scroll past. Every image is about a person, a place, or a thing. It's by an author. It started its life some part of some publication or somewhere on the internet. And it has been, you know, reposted on various social platforms as it traveled across the internet. Mine allows all this knowledge to be permanently recorded and to live with the image forever. And some more practical use cases we've thought of are, imagine being able to share music with a friend just by sending them the album art via iMessage. Mine will resolve the album art to the musician, the cover artist, and links to retrieve the actual music on YouTube, Spotify, or even purchase it directly from the artist. Imagine if you see a beautiful mid-century modern chair on a design blog, and you can use Mine to find out who the manufacturer is and purchase it directly from the manufacturer, not from Amazon. Imagine you wanted to share a recipe with your mom, and you could just send her a picture of a salad that you loved. And by virtue of seeing that image has previously been annotated with the ingredients and the directions to make that salad. So Mine allows creators to permanently sign their works and experts to annotate the works of others. We're looking for people to join the Mine community and help annotate the visual history of the world. We are image experts, we are creators, collectors, and curators, and we currently have a beta, and we're looking for help to build our platform and community. So thank you, and you can check out and sign up at minewith3ms.com.
Next we have Jean-Marc Alexia, who is the Senior Director of Product Management at DxO1, for the DxO1. And DxO is a website many of you might know that did rankings, and then they got into the hardware business, interestingly enough, and he's gonna talk a little bit about that, as well as get into what differentiates the camera. He's an electrical engineer by trade and worked several years on machine vision, and DxO is a French company, correct, that has venture backing, so they have not announced how much money they've gotten, but they, you know, they're in it for real with somebody helping them to make all this hardware. So Jean-Marc, welcome. Come on up and tell us about the DxO1.
What I'm going to introduce to you is actually a little bit of story about DxO itself, and then the DxO1, which is the first hardware exhibit of DxO. So DxO started 15 years ago and is well-known in the business, in the photography business, because RAW and image quality is our religion. So we started by ranking all the equipments available on the market, and especially the lenses, the sensors, and their capacity to provide the best image quality, whatever the case is, and especially in low light. So as we could be compared to the Dolby Digital Labs for the noise, for the sound, we are in this area for the image quality. So beside the, all the labs and the analysis of the quality of the equipment available on the market, we also raised a lot of algorithms that we put in softwares, so we are also known for softwares in improving image quality based on our measurement done on the sensors and the lenses. But this is the visible part of the iceberg. The first one is the DxO Mark, which is that website Noah was mentioning, which is dedicated to provide all the ranking and all the measurements on sensors and lenses. And we had also on a visible part of the iceberg those software, but the hidden part of the software is the embedded imaging, where we are present in 300 million devices today. So when we talk about those devices, obviously we are mentioning smartphones, tablets, these kind of devices, and I cannot tell you which company we are working with, but you can imagine with this number that all the most famous ones are part of our customers. And the interesting thing with this technology meant for smartphones is that you know that those imagers are basically very thin devices. The form factor is very important. So in all those cases, the challenge is always to make the smallest possible these sensors and lenses. So we are experts in this area, but we wanted to bring this kind of technology to another level, the level that you can reach with DSLRs, with high-end experts compact cameras, this kind of quality, which is not achievable because the physics is the same for everybody. And when you want to grab photons, you need to have big pixels and high-quality pixels. So we came up with a new kind of camera, which is the one I'm wearing here. It's like the current tie we have at DxO. This is a kind of camera which is basically based on the same kind of technology than the one used on the smartphones, but put on steroids. So we kind of boost the size of every component, but it's the same raw concept, and I will detail it. This camera is called the DxO1. It's lighter than an iPhone 5, for instance. It's very, very light. It's less than 3 inches height. And basically, if you want to understand what it is, it's smaller than a grip of a DSLR. It's actually the size of the battery of most DSLRs. What we have inside is a 20 million pixel, 1-inch format sensor, backlit. It's actually the same sensors as the one on the RX100-3 from Sony. But the good thing in this design is when I was talking about the sensor that we can find on the smartphones, but under steroids, is that you may see here that the sensor is very, very close to the lenses. And that's one of the main feature from the smartphones technologies. You got to stack up everything in a very, very small space. Obviously, all the other cameras, and especially even the mirrorless, by the way, you always have a flange back between the last lens and the sensor. So on DSLRs, it's meant to have the mirror moving. On mirrorless, you still have this flange back. So it means that in terms of capacity, what we can achieve here is extraordinary. But the challenge is, because we don't have flange back, and we call that airless design, there is a very high stress put on the lenses and the way we're going to build them. So in terms of comparison, it's a third of the size of the smallest known 1-inch sensor camera. So it's actually the smallest camera with such a big sensor. So it works great as a standalone camera. And you can see, you can search on the hashtag DxO1. There are already a good chunk of photos from the community, including professional photographers using this camera in a context where they used to use other DSLRs and high-end cameras. So what you've seen here is the ability to instantly share the results given by those 20 million pixel 1-inch sensor technology associated with a prime lens. So this is very important and different from other alternatives. We wanted it to be wired. It's not a Wi-Fi connection between your smartphone and the camera. It's a direct connection through the lightning. This design is patent pending, obtained this year. And this integrated lightning connector opens up, like you see here, by sliding the cover. And then you just have to connect it to your smartphone or tablet, thanks to the lightning connector, to enter this world of very high-end and very nice portraits, for instance, thanks to the bokeh that you can get with such a sensor in such a small volume. The ability to share is because we are relying on the share kit available through the iOS ecosystem. And then you can definitely access any kind of app available through the service supported on iOS 9. Beside the instant sharing, stunning portraits. Like I said, we have a 20 million pixel sensor associated with a 32 millimeter equivalent focal lens with an aperture f1.8. So this allows you to get the bokeh effect, which is the shallow depth of field and the blurry background. Those photos have been taken by Vincent Laforet in Iceland. And this is for real. And by the way, these photos are not even the raw post-processing, it's just the JPEG. In terms of comparison, if you want to understand what is the difference between an iPhone 6 and the DxO1, this is the photo taken with an iPhone 6. And this is the equivalent taken with the DxO1, where you can see the bokeh effect. But this technology is mainly amazing in low light because we have such a big sensor in such a small space, and because of the wide aperture lens, and also because RAW is our religion. So we know, in this case, with the post-processing, how to tackle the noise everywhere there is a problem. Another comparison in terms of lightning, because there is the noise on the one side, but also the lightning. Another comparison between the iPhone 6 and the DxO1. One of our ambassadors, which is with John Stanmayer, now playing since 3 months with the camera as crazy. And you can meet him tomorrow on the PhotoPlus Expo booth, DxO booth at PhotoPlus Expo. Is playing with this camera and is convinced by the fact that, first of all, because of the way you operate it, it's like a reminder of the old Rolleiflex in the digital era, but also is getting 3 more stops thanks to this technology and all the components involved. And this is the kind of result obtained with this little camera. So it's a super RAW, and I'm going to detail what is that. It's another disruptive technology. It's a super RAW in long time exposure. So the Milky Way over there is for real. What about super RAW? So super RAW is a new standard. It's some kind of, we could call that HDR-like bracketing RAW photos, but the meaning of it is to tackle the noise. So what we do, as the noise is a random from one picture to another one, then we're going to shoot 4 rows in a row at a very high speed, 22 frames per second, and we're going to build a meta RAW file called super RAW, which is the combination of those 4 rows file. And then we are able to apply not only the spatial denoising, but also the temporal denoising on it. four rows in a row, combine into a super row. And this is the kind of difference. On the left, you have the super row. On the right, you have the row post-processed. And just for the anecdote, this photo shot with the iPhone 6, you had only those two red lights from the helmets of the people. And then we are also, because we have those software and all those nice algorithms, we are providing our own solution to develop those super row. It's called Connect. So as a summary, this is a brand new camera. This is a new way to handle a camera, and I will show you after this panel how to operate the camera. It's pretty nice. It's really a new way to interact with a camera, especially in street photography. You have the ability to shoot from the waist, like with an old Rolleiflex, because the camera swivels compared to the iPhone, which is only used as a viewfinder and a control panel. Thank you.
Raw is our religion. Anybody else? Can you relate? You go to that church? So our final speaker before we go to the panel questions is Matt Zeiler. He's the founder and CEO of Clarifai. There has been a huge explosion in the capabilities around artificial intelligence and machines' ability to see what's in a photo in the last couple of years. And if you don't follow the space, you might not realize it, but it's really been a magnificent breakthrough. And Matt's at the forefront of that, and he really is quite pioneering. He actually studied with some fairly legendary people in the field. One of his professors is now actually part of the AI image recognition group at Facebook, and another one is at Google Brain. So he's really connected in with the forefront of what's happening. And so Matt, come on up and give us a demo of what Clarifai does and have our minds blown.
All right. So Clarifai is really trying to understand visual content to extract that value that we are all creating when we're taking pictures and capturing memories. And we do this with artificial intelligence. We have automatic algorithms that can understand this content and provide actionable insights into them. And this is a huge problem that faces all of us here who are taking pictures and sharing them, either as a consumer or a pro photographer or as an enterprise. There's just massive amounts of content being created and nobody really understands what it is and can get the value out of it. So as an example, there's 1 trillion photos taken in 2015 alone, 5 trillion, 5x by 2017, 400 hours of video up to YouTube every minute, even more on DropCam, 100 billion frames every hour with the DropCam home security device, and 50 billion pins on Pinterest. Just massive amounts of content that we really want to understand with our technology. And the best way to explain it is to show you how it works with a live demo. So this is our homepage, and you can visit it yourselves as well and try it out with your own images. I just have a few on the desktop here, and I can grab any image, drag it onto the homepage. There's a quick CAPTCHA to make sure we don't get crawled. The image is uploaded and automatically understood. So what you saw there in the blue bar was the image being uploaded, the image on the left-hand side. The algorithms we've developed look at only the pixels of the image. No metadata is attached to it or anything like that. It looks at these pixels and predicts the tags you see in the middle. These are the top 10 most relevant tags that the model thinks are most related to that input image. You see objects like heart being predicted, but even descriptive words like love and romance or Valentine's Day are known to be associated with hearts, and so the model understands that and can predict it. On the right-hand side, we also have other technology that instead of predicting tags, it predicts the most relevant content out of a whole data set of content. So out of millions of images, it retrieved these ones on the right-hand side that are most related to the input image on the left. And let's try a more difficult example. And you see here, it's predicting even the castle in the background, as well as all the context around it. And for those professional photographers out there, it predicts tags like this, nobody, which is actually really valuable after we talked to a few pro photographers. For licensing content, you want to know whether there's a person there or not so that you can get the right license on it and get the right attribution. And you can see, again, the visual lookups. Now, it doesn't, oops, somebody copied something. So it also works on video. So I just pasted in a URL to a video, and the servers are downloading this in the back end, and it's running our algorithms throughout the entire video. And it just finished. That was a 3.5-minute video. It completely understood. And it understood it in 10,000 different ways. Our models understand 10,000 things about the world. And it returned these results as a set of lines here. I'm just going to clean them up for a second. Maybe I'm looking for all the scenes in this video that have mountains. And you can see the height of the line is corresponding to how confident the model thinks that there's a mountain in this part of the video. So you can jump right to the scenes that you're most excited about. Maybe you're looking for snowy mountains. You can see in this part of the video, it's not confident in snow, but in this section, it's confident that both snow and mountain are present. So it can directly jump to that. So you can power very informative searches directly into the video content. And this is much different than what a human would tag in this content. They might say that a mountain appears somewhere in this video, or there's some snow, or it's a hiking video. But they're not going to say at the 37th second or whenever it is that this has a forest and a mountain and a car. That's not the level of detail a human wants to do by themselves and sit there. That's not an exciting process. But we can get all that value out of the video by doing it automatically. And what we do on each image and video is run what are called neural networks. And this is kind of a cartoon version of those. They're basically a bunch of neurons, they're called. They try and simulate how the brain works, just like the neurons in your head, that look at the pixels of the image and try and extract information from it, whether it's the sun, a clock, clouds. And it runs through multiple layers of these neurons and finally gives you a prediction, gives you some idea of what is in that content. The actual neural networks we use are much more complicated than this. There's many, many layers, nearing 100 layers in these networks. And even then, they're nowhere near as complicated as the brain. Nobody really understands how the brain works, but these algorithms are trying to simulate that. And what they do to learn all this information is they go through a training phase where they look at millions and millions of images that have been labeled by people and try and understand, given these pixels, how do I predict the categories that I'm told to predict? And this training phase looks at millions of images, goes for several days or weeks, and then the result is all of these connections you see in the neural network are learned so that it can see any new image or new video and automatically recognize those concepts. And we offer that up to developers and enterprises as a service. So we're up in the cloud. You can send images and videos through an API, and we quickly return results to you telling you the people that are in them, the objects, and even these descriptive high-level terms. And we're building it to be really accessible to anybody, whether you're an indie developer in your garage or a Fortune 500 company. It scales for any application, and we have different tiers to help you out. So where is this being applied? You can see from the video example, it's a very powerful way to understand what parts of a long video contain the content you're most interested in. So you can use that to quickly edit your content in the way you want it. And when you're thinking of, 2-hour feature-length films, that's already an edited version. There's many, many more times the content that's being captured by multiple viewpoints, and all of that is being processed manually today. So we can speed up that process in video editing. Television, if we watch all the channels that you regularly watch, we can tell you exactly what's on any channel. Maybe you're looking to see a soccer game or a basketball game. You don't have to go through the guide anymore. You could actually automatically see if that's even a commercial within a different television show. You could jump to that and catch it. So we can actually understand this video in real time or faster. Advertising, whether it's image or video, understanding the context around an image that's posted online with these trillion that are being posted in 2015, if we can understand those trillion images, we really know what people are there to see. Whether you're scrolling through your Instagram feed or reading a news article, if we can tell what's in the image as well as the rest of the website, we can give much more context to advertisers to find actually relevant content. And very closely related to that is cleaning up social media feeds. And it could be that you want to power more informative search to find the content that is most interesting to you. And the problem with social media is people hashtag this content, but it's not actually hashtags that are relevant to the objects or the pixels of the image that are there. It's funny hashtags or some event that you're at, but they're not the actual content. So we can actually understand that and do a lot of different use cases from search to moderation, et cetera. And here's just a handful of the community that we're building around this technology. So these are all customers of ours using it for a variety of different use cases. Vimeo is improving their search engine by using our context on their video to tag it automatically. Vodafone's building applications for cell phones directly on top of our APIs. Dove wants to understand how their brand is being talked about across social media channels. Curate's doing this for other brands as well. And then this company in the bottom left, iInside, it's actually a medical company. They have a really interesting device that attaches to the back of your cell phone. And it's a lens that can take pictures inside your nose, mouth, and ears. And we can automatically predict a dozen different diseases inside your ears. So they have it in hospitals, and doctors are using it today, and they're basically labeling the data. We're training a model to recognize those categories, and then they want to get it out of the hospitals into the hands of nurses, into the hands of consumers directly, and into developing countries where there's just not enough doctors to go around. So we're really excited about new opportunities like that that this technology empowers. And for the photographers out there, this is a really powerful technology when it's tied to search. So here's a quick demo of stock photo images. So if I just do a random search, this is what they look like. But I can search for something like car, and it automatically retrieves cars. So the only input to the system was these stock photos. There was no tags attached to them. This is automatically predicted with our tool. And you can browse around and look at the tags. But as you see when I'm hovering over, you get this little eyeball. If I click on it, what it does there is a visual search. So exactly what you saw on our homepage, showing similar images, you can do that kind of in real time. You can see the search bar has car and a picture of a car. If I remove the word, then it's only looking at that image and trying to find the most similar other images. So you can imagine browsing around a huge catalog, not sure exactly what the content is called or tagged with that you're looking for, but you know you want something more like this and less like this. So you can click around without typing any keywords and find that content. And you can see it even retrieves visually similar content. And let's say you see results like this. Maybe you're looking for a real image, not cartoons. So you can easily move more in that direction. So that's just a touch on what we do and how we power a variety of different applications. Thank you.
So one of the things that I, you know, since we're trying to be entrepreneurial and talk about, and we're talking about startups and people already have funding, one of the things I would challenge you and the audience to think about as we discuss and you think about questions is, imagine that you had $1 million to invest. What would you ask these guys to convince you to spend that money on them, right? I mean, like, what is the question that you feel like, all right, if I'm going to give you my actual money, what would you ask them to convince you to put it in? Which one would you do it to? So with that, I'll ask a couple of questions, but please, you know, raise your hand after we chat. Ooh, okay, and then we'll go from there. So is it good? It's working, right? Okay. He just got back from the Ukraine, so I'm sure he's fine. So great. So I want to start with Jean-Marc, actually, with a question about the DX01, which is that given that you already had technology in so many different devices, what was the thing that you saw missing in the marketplace when you've got all these companies out there? Like, what was the thing missing that you said, okay, we've got to actually now build our own camera?
Yeah, it's quite simple. We wanted to have a car key size camera. We wanted to be able to have the highest quality always with us, mm-hmm. in our pockets, in our shirt pockets.
Yeah.
You know, not a purse, not a bag, or always with us. Actually, I have two cameras in my pocket right now.
Hold it up. You've got one around your neck, right?
Yeah. This is that tiny. Okay. So it operates in standalone.
So let me ask you a different question about that, which is, so basically Sony or Canon or somebody could have made one this size if they'd wanted to. So why didn't they?
The one of the main reasons is they do not operate that deep in this ALS technology. Mm-hmm. The thing is that we've developed a lot of algorithm, and we were also masters in implementing wrong lenses combined with good sensors, and thanks to the computational, being able to retrieve the best results from both. Mm-hmm. So intentionally, we were able to put wrong lenses to be able to play with their characteristics.
Yeah.
And Sony, Nikon, Canon, they are focused, sorry for the pun, they are focused on the fact that they have all this historical and legacy stuff behind them.
Yeah.
So this is the reason why it's disruptive to them. We will see how they're going to react, mm-hmm. definitely.
Yep.
But it's a different approach, and it's coming from the smartphones. Mm-hmm. Even at Sony, who is the only one manufacturer of DSLRs also owning a branch with smartphones, it's not the same people working on these imagers. Mm-hmm. There is the smartphone branch, and there is the camera branch.
Right.
So now they will be perhaps forced to work together
a
little bit more.
Interesting. Denis, so your model is actually a weird inversion of the way people think about photography or how to monetize photography right now on the internet, which is that the way you put it in a conversation we had recently was that really people work off of a scarcity model, which is this idea that you have this one thing, it has the most value, and you're sort of turning that inverse, right? Can you explain what that difference is?
Yeah. one of the big inspirations kind of for mine and some of the people I work with was our background in piracy. And as kids, we felt very empowered, kind of spending nights on IRC channels, sharing files. I was personally responsible for around the time where HDTV technology, you could capture HDTV signal over the air and record it on this a PCI card. It was just fascinating seeing what kind of organic communities, the kind of infrastructure they built to distribute media before Netflix, before like Spotify and things mm-hmm. like that. And it was a sort of an entirely vertically integrated distribution system where all the participants were incentivized to contribute from capturing the content to spreading it all over the place. And it was just, for me, it was empowering to contribute to this without thinking of the repercussions of copyright, but it also like taught me about a reality of just how the internet works and how this technology, basically technology will figure itself out and it will figure out how to get information to the people that want it. So when you brought up the JPEG group, wanting to implement DRM. Mm-hmm. Basically, the entire history of the internet has shown that any restriction of information flowing has not succeeded, and it will not mm-hmm. succeed. So I think that kind of the most savvy creators and artists today embrace the scale of the internet, and they understand that they will not be successful contributors if they worry about scarcity. So mine is trying to embrace, basically, is trying to embrace the scale and saying that, mm-hmm. great, if your information is spreading and it's reaching a wide audience, you are doing something right. But the internet is fundamentally broken the way it is today because it doesn't reward your identity, and your identity is not present next to your media. And mine wants to build tools and technology to make that persistent and embrace scale.
It requires a different way of thinking about making money, which I want to come back to. But Matt, so what I'm interested, there are some very obviously useful features of what your technology can do. But there strikes me that there are also some potential, or perhaps there are some limitations. And I guess one of my questions is really about what are the limitations still in AI. One of them, I believe, is that you can differentiate between a photograph of mountains and whether it has snow on it, but the emotional tone of like how, where are we, how close are we to being able to say I want something that shows two people who are in love or who are crying, who are sad, and can we develop emotional cues, like can it read emotion yet?
Yeah, that's a good question. So our default model in our system understands 10,000 different concepts, and it understands objects like heart you saw, castle, tree, etc. But it also does understand these high-level descriptive things. One really interesting one is togetherness. It retrieves that or predicts that when shown images of two people holding hands, two people hugging, or even a person holding a dog in their arms. Mm. This really high-level understanding of the image is already happening with these systems, and it's only going to get better and better over time. And I think there's going to be a lot of different fusion between different types of data that help that out, whether it's reading stories to give the ability of storytelling to these models so that they can not just predict tags, but actually talk about the image like we want to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great. Do you folks have some questions you want to ask? Yes, right back there, yeah.
Do you believe that in 5 years you're going to be making cameras still, or you're going to be selling technology for the camera phones?
Probably both.
Why?
One of the reasons is that this is the first outcome of a wide adventure. Noah was mentioning the L16 from Light. That's not new to us. We explore a lot of things of this kind. So we will definitely, it's a new turn for DxO. DxO spent 15 years in softwares and ranking cameras and labs and embedded, but it's a new turn, it's a new venture for us, new venture capitalist maybe, but it's a new adventure for us, definitely, and it's something that will last.
Yes.
Hold on, let me give you my microphone.
You mentioned in your presentation that with mine, the author data would be embedded into the image, but also that you can, sorry, I'm just trying to talk to you around the photographer, but that anyone would be able to edit or add other information to the image file. So how do you protect the author data, and how would you prevent someone from just going in and adding random garbage to the file?
Yeah, that's a great question. We are building Mine as a community, and we're inspired by other communities that have existed on the internet, and I mentioned some of them, such as Wikipedia, where sort of, if you think about Wikipedia, every time I read like the history of Wikipedia, it sounds like such a crazy idea that like the original wiki tool gives everyone basically permission to modify the entire document, but it preserves the history. And that seems like the obvious thought would be that, well, this would just be ruined by someone. But these communities have proven that there's a small subset of the entire user base that is very passionate about the specific content that they moderate. So basically, they become responsible moderators to ensure through this community reputation system that it is the correct information. But in mind, we envision that there will be a way to identify the actual creator and to give them reputation. So sort of a, for example, an artist could link their other social media identities to their mine identity. So if they have lots of social media account followers, you consider them a more reputable member of the community. So basically that community member, other users would vote on their claims of ownership and through a reputation system that the truth will be arrived at, but also through moderation, of course, that, yeah.
One follow-up I have to that is about mashups and how you're thinking or how that would be dealt with. In other words, so you have a picture that has many photographs in it, and attribution is, I don't know, changes, right?
Right. Yeah, and that's like kind of one of the most common questions we get is the idea of derivative works and reusing other works as inspiration, appropriation, has been a practice, widely throughout the 20th century. There's tons of recent news cases of, for example, Richard Prince appropriating Instagram posts, turning them into paintings that he sells for, hundreds of thousands of dollars. I think the goal is to just create tools that where there, there is a platform and a forum for all versions to exist and for them to have their own records, and basically that as long as the lineage of the work and the derivation is preserved and someone who is interested can see the entire history of it, that is what is important. And it is up to, the community to make a judgment call. Is this an actual original work? Is someone claiming, a Walker Evans photo as now because they, flipped it 180 degrees, or if a male artist's work was appropriated by a female artist, is that warrant enough, new ideas to the work for it to warrant anything? And I think that some of those works are some of the most interesting works, and we think that they will be the most popular works to discover and learn about online.
Yes, question over there.
So I'm interested in what's more revolutionary and where you guys see kind of revolutions developing. Because I guess, obviously, technology is going to enable processing to get better and cameras to get smaller. And on the discovery side, you're going to be able to do some things that kind of keep up with the web and allow this stuff to, are going to help people to be able to find images better and to be able to do maybe more creative things with them through apps and that kind of thing. How does that actually change photography? What's the real benefit that you see of these tools to photography as a medium? Or how do you see new mediums evolving to keep up with the technologies that you guys are developing?
Matt, why don't you start with that one, yeah?
Sure, so one concrete use case comes to mind of our technology where we power a lot of stock photography websites. And the use case there is to get right at the upload process and make it easier and faster to upload new content to the marketplace. And we do that by automatically predicting what the content is, because a lot of these sites ask users to manually tag it. So we take a 1-2 minute process and do it in a fraction of a second. So now pro photographers can get much more content into the marketplace, get their latest shots, and worry about taking great photography rather than worrying about figuring out which tags are going to make it sell. That's our job, and we can do that automatically. And the flip side of that is when the buyer visits the marketplace, they get a consistent view of all photographers. It's not that one photographer put the right set of tags on to optimize the buyer's experience. We make it kind of a level playing field. So the best quality of photography is going to be discovered, which is really exciting, and a new possibility enabled by this technology.
Do either of you, Jean-Marc or Denis, do you want to speak to that as well?
Sure. Yeah, I think that's an interesting question. like the problem I have with the reason it's difficult to talk about is because we have a very limited vocabulary that we use. We use the word photography, and I think photography means very different things to different people. I think like when I, as I was prefacing my presentation, like when I went into an art school to study photography, I had this idea of photography, and I was saying like when we were gonna like, you know, they could kill us if they wanted to take out like the analog color printing machine. Like that is one kind of photography, but I think like photography today has a completely different meaning. And I think it all, like the reason I became interested in doing what I'm trying to do now is because I think it all comes down to like the amount of free time people have and what they choose to do with their free time. And I think like no matter how much I wanted to take like 35 millimeter photos, I was worried that with my 35 millimeter photos, no one would give them the time of day because the technology that became massive, which is smartphones basically, that ended up taking people's time. And then the reality of it is like if you're taking the Q train and you're on Canal Street in the tunnel, you know, if you look around, everyone's playing Bejeweled, and once you get outside and there's signal, like everyone's scrolling up in their feed, and like that is how people are going to spend their time. And like I am worried about like what can I do as like a technologist and an artist to affect how people will spend their time positively, because no matter what, like the you know, the technology would win, and it's, you know, it's not even like Apple's decision or the guys who made Instagram's decision. It's sort of like a technological determinism that ends up that this technology propagates and we can't do anything about it.
So I'm going to talk about the hardware, not only our product, but mainly the hardware. So one of the main thing happening right now is that we are filling some gaps between historical components, cameras, and next generation. So you have seen Lytro, you have seen this kind of brands trying to bring up new way to grab and snap photons. So this is photography, you know, grabbing the photons and getting this memory of where they're at. And filling these gaps is probably a kind of shy revolution, because it's not, you know, spinning around everything. But filling these gaps is very important, because right now, if we are talking about high-end DSLRs, you have very fast cameras, but you cannot share the result as fast as you grab it. And on the other end, you have lower-hand cameras, very oriented to sharing pictures. And what we are trying to achieve with our product, for instance, is to fill this gap where you will have high-end quality cameras shareable instantly.